Aki Karim here for BBTV. I'm joined by highly renowned trainer Shane McGuigan. We're at an actual venue which is bustling right now. Did you expect there's cakes going off, being caught, fireworks? Did you expect such a turnout or just an actual contract signing?
No, I mean, look, it's Adam's birthday on Wednesday, so he just turned 19. I didn't expect such a big turnout, but when he mentioned it, I said, well, first signing. But it's also, it's good because it's, you know, it's Adam and Hassan, they've been boxing since they were kids. Do you know what I mean? They've had, I think Hassan had about 87 and Adam had like mid 70 amateur fights. It's a long time. It's a long time to be putting in towards the sport of boxing. And to go pro, even though they'd had their pro licenses before, but to actually get a new signing and to sort of announce yourself and your team moving forward, and your, you know what I mean, a PR company, your sports management PR company, your boxing management, and also your boxing trainer. That's a pretty big deal. So it's a great thing to do. I think everyone should do it.
Absolutely. And you know what? It does show that you're probably gonna have some big nights with the following and everything like that, doesn't it? As you touched on the stage. But you know, you've been there before. You've trained world champions and high caliber fighters. So this is on a boxing level. What did you see in the boys where you thought, you know what, actually they could mix it in a gym like mine?
Yeah, I mean, I saw Adam come down and spar Luke Campbell. And you know, as I said up there on the stage, I said, you know, he literally rolled out the car and just put his gum shield in and did six rounds straight off the bat. I was surprised at the age of him. I just thought, you know, and it wasn't just the way he sparred. It was like, it was a very competitive spar. It wasn't like one of them got the better, but it was the fact that he was able to mix it at length with Luke. Everyone that spars Luke goes, after a few rounds, they think, oh, I can't keep this pace up. I'm going to just put my hands up and walk him down. So, you know, Adam was trying to do it on the outside, and I thought that's really, it's a really intense thing to try and do, especially being 18 years of age. I was shocked at his age. Hassan then had a few spars in my gym, and I thought he was really talented as well. So he has a bit more power and a bit more like range at, you know, at distance, and uses his feet really well. So, you know, it's exciting. You know, we're gonna look after the boys, and we're gonna take them forward. And it's not gonna be a short journey. It's a long old career boxing, especially when you're turning pro so young. You know, I had Josh Taylor, unified world champion after 16 fights, but Adam will be more than that, and Hassan will be even more than that, because he needs a little bit more work. The welterweight division's got more depth to it, so you know, welter, light, middle, we don't know where he's going to go yet, but it's just, they've got bundles of talent, and more importantly, that, you know, Azeem's a nice guy, nice family, and if you're going to be spending a lot of years with these guys, you've got to make sure that they're good people, and I definitely saw that.
Yeah, and as you say, it is a long journey. Now, your gym itself is on a roll at the minute. You've got current world champions in the gym. You've got a lot of experienced heads in there, a lot of really, really gifted fighters. How do two young novices fit into that? And is that going to be a bit of a challenge for you as well as a trainer that you're looking forward to as well?
Yeah, I mean, look, I'm going to have a lot of Olympians probably come to me. You know, the last Olympics, I had about six of them. I chose not to work with quite a lot of them because they had a lot of people that were attached to them, and it wasn't fitting with my stable at the time. But remodeled, you know, we've linked up with First Access as well, so it's something different. We're bringing something different to the table. It allows us to hit all angles of the boxer, because it's building the brand outside the ring, not just in it. You know what I mean? So they'll mix in really good. I mean, the good thing is that they're around elite quality fighters all the time. So the fact that they're able to do that, see how world champions like Lawrence Coley, see how guys like Daniel Dubois train, Chris Burns-Smith, Fowler. Do you know what I mean? Like, they're going to be surrounded by quality people, and they're only going to see quality. It's going to help bring them on. But I'm going to take some more prospects on from the amateurs. I'm probably going to get some guys coming out of the Olympics. I think I might have a few got my eye on a few guys. So I think we'll have a setup so that we'll have prospects and champions, because I always had that. I had Josh Tate, like when I had George Groves, Hay, Frampton, all at the top level. I had Josh Pritchard, Anthony Kikachi, Josh Taylor. You know what I mean? Those guys are underneath that were the next wave. Do you know what I mean? So, and that's the way I've always worked my business, because I know that you can't just invest in your gym at the top end. You've got to always continue to have your eye out for the next talent.
It's interesting to hear you say that, because when you speak to a lot of trainers, they actually talk about trying to downsize the stable or focus on one or two fighters. You seem to be at plans to expand the stable and to almost build, not a factory, but you know what I mean, a stable where you've got a conveyor belt.
Yeah. The thing is for me, like, I always had a small stable, right? And I always thought that I would lose quality if I overpopulated my gym. We got to a stage where I was like, do you know what? Taylor left. Luke's at the end of his career. Like, he was having one or two fights a year. Lawrence was in the gym, but if Lawrence boxed and he was out, it was only going to be Fowler and CBS. And I thought, it's about building an environment. I went out to Robert Garcia's gym a few years ago, and I looked around, and it was this depth of the talent was just like, they're feeding off each other. Like, EIS, Sheffield, like, you know, they've got a handful of coaches up there, but it's the talent that's breeding the other talent. Do you know what I mean? It's like, the fact that they're all getting quality sparring and that they're all training and pushing each other on, it's good to have depth in the stable. And for me, I wanted to have, like, I want to try and do the Robert Garcia version of the UK. So I'm able to say, like, well, I got a gym full of 20 boys. I train 6 or 7, do you know what I mean? And I co-train another few, and then I've got a few assistants that work underneath me. But they're getting quality sparring and they're in a great, great environment. And then over the time, then say they got the last 5 weeks, I'm like, okay, I'm gonna knuckle down and start train, you know, doing all the sessions. And it's like, but they'll still, because that's what you really need. You don't, first 5 weeks of a training camp, you're getting fit. And then the next 5 weeks, you're doing the tactical stuff. And if I've got a good assistants and good people in the gym, then the gym will be better than ever, in my opinion.
Yeah, and you know, the first fights for these guys are probably not too far in the distant future. I know you like to work on things really analytically and in depth. Now, obviously, you're not going to have time to do that to your high standards for the first fight together, but yeah. do you see them being quite quick learners and you being able to progress them quite quickly?
Definitely, they're both quick learners. I always knew Adam was going to be, but Hassan actually adapts really, really quick too. Hassan needs a little bit more to time on the inside, doing more rounds, do you know what I mean? Whereas Adam, he's quite comfortable in close. So, you know, actually, if anything, I have to work on fighting from the outside a little bit. Just not just being defensive on the outside with Adam, it's actually about being utilizing your strength and being a bit busier on the outside. So, just, you know, like Khalil, the coach from before, he's done a fantastic job. But just having a little bit more experience and having, you know, like in myself, will allow them to really fulfill their potential.
It really does sound like it's going to be an exciting journey. I don't want to keep it too much of your time, so I know you've had a lot of stream of media, but just one final thing. We've got a big fight coming up, Usyk and Joshua. Of course, you've got cruiserweight champion in your stable, and we'd be quite interested to see how you know, a big cruiserweight does against a big heavyweight. And in essence, how do you see the fight going as well?
He's not a big cruiserweight, Usyk. He really isn't. I mean, he's not much bigger than someone like Chris Billings-Smith. And Chris, you know, like, he couldn't go to heavyweight. I mean, he could, but you'd have to be very... You couldn't put Chris Billings-Smith in against Joe Joyce, for instance, for 12 rounds. He has the technical ability to box his ears off, but it's just the size and the stature. Do you know what I mean? You couldn't even put Chris Billings-Smith in against someone like Derek Chisora, because just the physicality, it's not, and that's where heavyweight division, it's like, sometimes people can look so technically bad, but they're getting so much success. And Usyk has maximized every ounce of his technical ability, and he's trying now to maximize every ounce of his size, but he's just a smaller guy. It's going to be an interesting fight. You talk about genuine cruiserweights, right? The only guy to really move up, well, there's two guys that moved up and won world titles, it's David Haye and Evander Holyfield. But Haye's body broke down when he went to heavyweight because he wasn't naturally that big. You see him now after he finished, he's slimmed right down. So Evander Holyfield's a genuine, massive, big lump that's thickened out. He was a cruiserweight when he was young, he thickened out and he became a fully fledged heavyweight. Lawrence Okolie is of that ilk. He's the guy that's actually going to be able to go into the heavyweight division, thicken out, and actually probably be a size bigger than some heavyweights. Do you know what I mean? I've got Dan Dubois in the gym, and there's not much of a size discrepancy there. It's just thickness. So I don't think Usyk's going to have the strength, the ability to be able to withstand him for more than 8 rounds. He'll be able to outbox him, but as soon as he gets hit with the second, third, fourth shot on the inside, as soon as AJ starts leaning on him, wearing him out in close, Terry Chisora did a good job of it. He just didn't have the speed to punch in combination. He hurt him a few times throughout the fight. Chisora hurt Usyk a few times, but he never had the snap. Whereas AJ's got that snap, he's got that ability. If AJ stands up and tries to box long for a bit, he's going to get picked off, but he'll then have a second, he'll have a plan B, and he'll have to start forcing the fight. And I think once he does that, it'll be game over.
Sounds like you've already got a little bit of a plan A and plan B for when Lawrence eventually decides to move to heavyweight as well. So
exactly.
That's great to hear. But Shane, I really appreciate your time. Thanks so much for sitting down with me.
No worries.
And like I say, best of luck with all your future endeavours.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.